Welcome to Retouch Pro Live. I'm your host, Doug Nelson. Thank you for being here with us today. Before we begin, let me show you how you can interact with us. You should see a panel looking very similar to this. You might need to click the little arrowhead here, or it could be a plus sign depending on your operating system. Make this pane drop down. You type your question in here and you hit send. That's really all you need to worry about it. Feel free to type things all during the show. If I can work them into Lee's presentation during the show, I will. Otherwise, we will come back to them at the end. Things are going to be moving quite quickly today, as per usual. As a matter of fact, maybe even more so than usual. But the show is being recorded and will be uploaded to YouTube afterwards, so you can review it at your leisure, rewind and skip around and find the little spots you missed. If you are viewing us right now on YouTube, hi there, welcome. If you could take a second to click the little thumbs up like button right now, I'd appreciate it. And don't forget to subscribe to us. And then whenever you're done viewing, feel free to leave some comments, your opinion of the show. All of that is very helpful. Let's see here. I think that covers most of it. Let me remind everyone that if you are not currently registered over at RetouchPro.com, you most certainly should. That will allow you to participate in our forums, including our photography forum, which some people are surprised we even have one there, but it's actually quite active and quite interesting. That will also put you on the email list to be notified for future shows. And while you're there, if you click on the site nav link and go down and check out our Retouch Pro videos, I would certainly appreciate it. These run the gamut all the way from the most basic introductory shows to some of the most hair-curlingly, ear-smokingly advanced stuff you would ever want to see. They are all a minimum of 2 hours long. Some of them are closer to 3 hours long. A great many of them are real-time, start-to-finish retouches. But as I said, we have them covering just about every possible topic. Okay. Lee Varis is a photographer and photo illustrator whose work I can just about guarantee you've seen it if you've ever watched a movie or rented a video or played a video game. I'm sure you've come across his work somewhere along the lines, although a lot of it is very behind the scenes. I know my first exposure to Lee was about 15 years ago at a conference, and he introduced himself as the guy that glues Angelina Jolie's head on Lara Croft's body for the posters. From that moment forward, I was enamored, and I knew this was a man that I needed to get to know. He is also quite literally the man that wrote the book on the digital zone system. We will be talking more about that at the end of the show. We will show you all about that book at that time. But enough about that. Let's switch over to Lee's screen.
Okay. Show my. So are you seeing now?
There we go.
The Welcome. New digital zone system there?
Yes, we are. Welcome back to Retouch Pro Live, Lee.
All right. Well, thank you. Thanks for having me.
Your previous show has been one of our best most viewed shows we've done since we rebooted this show last year. I'm serious. More people have viewed your hair masking show than have viewed the rest of our shows combined on YouTube right now. I don't know if that could be faint praise, but I find it very interesting, and so I am very pleased that you were willing to come back.
Well, thank you for having me. I'm pleased to be here.
Now, before you begin your presentation, and pardon me if you're going to be getting into this, but when Ansel Adams developed the zone system, or at least popularized the zone system, it was in response to the limitations of the silver photo process and the chemical process, and particularly the paper that was available at the time. And nowadays, we have, especially considering HDR and things along those lines, virtually unlimited dynamic range. Does that change the relevance at all?
Well, I mean, it's certainly a different animal. I mean, conceptually, it's very similar. The idea, you know, the basic idea is really to kind of test your equipment and your system, your imaging system, to make sure you know what it's doing. I mean, in the new digital zone system, we have zones, but really the ones that I'm primarily concerned with are zone 1 and 9.
Okay, I'll tell you what, maybe in case there are some novices in the audience, could we maybe back up and just maybe give a really broad definition about what is a zone system?
Well, Ansel Adams Zone System, and he was really the first photographer to kind of systematize and codify an approach to tone and contrast control in a very systematic way. So his notion was to divide the tonal range from black to white into 10 discrete steps, and he called these zones. So the idea was that you would test your exposure and change your exposure by one stop each time, and then that would generate a different zone for any particular tone that you were exposing for.
So basically, at zone 0 at one end, and is it zone 9 or zone 10 at the other end?
Well, yeah, zone 10. 0 would be absolute black, and 10 would be absolute white.
And then so, each step is literally one f-stop?
Each step in his system ended up being, he identified them by changing exposure by one stop. Now, it's maybe a little bit more complicated than that. And today we're not using film, so it's kind of trivial to generate a step wedge that is equally spaced.
Okay.
Film is not equally spaced. You know, the steps are not equally spaced because there's a kind of gamma curve on the film. Mm-hmm. But we don't actually need to be that concerned about the tones between, say, zone 9 and zone 1. Mm-hmm. Because we can push the tones around willy-nilly with almost complete control using Photoshop. Mm-hmm. So, but for a photographer, you still have to be concerned about exposing correctly for a value that you want to see detail in.
Okay.
And it's a bit easier to do this certainly with digital, but when you're capturing, there's a whole, exposure is still critical when you're when you're capturing an image. Mm-hmm. So the more we know about how the camera is actually recording those tones, the better. And it's also conceptually a way of understanding the value structure of an image, the lights and darks. So I'm going to launch into this here.
Okay.
And so we're going to sort of talk about how now digital system relates to the old system, so that we're not starting from scratch completely, but we're building on the conceptual foundation of the past.
Excellent.
Okay, so we're going to get in here, and basically we're talking about photography, which is capturing and sharing what we see, and this photographic process works pretty much like the human eye. You know, the eye has a lens that collects light and passes through to an adjustable iris. Controls how much light strikes the retina. And there it's translated into electrical signals that travel through the optic nerve to the brain, and it's processed into the images that we experience. Now, the modern digital camera basically replicates this process. It has a lens, it has an adjustable iris, and the light is collected onto a light-sensitive surface. So the surface nowadays, of course, is a CCD or a CMOS chip. Mm-hmm. Which has multiple densely packed collection sites on the surface of a silicon wafer. And this is designed to translate the light into electrical signals, which ultimately get passed onto a microprocessor or a mini computer that creates the digital image. Now, the eye has a very sophisticated collection of light-sensitive structures called rods and cones, And there are three types of cones that are sensitive to narrow bandwidths of light, representing red, green, and blue color. The rods are smaller and are only sensitive to brightness, but they're much more plentiful. And they're sort of packed in between the cones, except at the very center of the retina, in what is known as the fovea. So on the CCD, or CMOS chip, there's only one type of sensor receptor. And to differentiate them into colors, they put little filters over each receptor. So you have red, green, and blue filters, and they're in a pattern. So that these sensors really only capture brightness information. So we need to have these red, green, and blue filters over each sensor so we can actually determine the color. Because what you see here is the popular Bayer pattern, where green alternates with red and blue pixels such that there are twice as many green pixels as there are red or blue. Mm-hmm. So the digital camera records the varying brightnesses of these red, green, and blue pixels as electrical signals of varying strengths, and it results in each pixel receiving a numerical value in the raw file. Now, these pixels only represent brightness at the specific pixel sites on the chip. So later on in the post-processing, these values are blended together using a complex algorithm that determines the color of a particular pixel based on its initial color value combined with its immediate neighbors. So the red, green, and blue pixels are combined in an additive fashion to generate a full color image where each pixel is assigned an RGB value. Three numbers, regardless of the fact that only one value was originally recorded for each pixel. Okay, so all of this is just a preamble here to realize that digital cameras only record brightness values for the pixels representing the image, and that color is interpreted from these brightness values by determining under which pixel it's so bright under the red pixel or so bright under the green pixel, and then it requires a fair amount of complex calculation known as a demosaicing algorithm. And that happens in a separate stage, you know, from the actual image capture. Mm-hmm. We talk about color accuracy. That comes from comparing these calculated values to a known target and then adjusting for a match. And as it turns out, this is kind of a non-trivial process. They test it and work it out so that the camera produces an expected result. But in the end, the color is highly subjective. You know, what we decide is good color or bad color, because very often just accurate color is very bland and uninteresting. So almost every camera applies some kind of interpretation to the color to make it look more pleasing. And that varies, you know, and it also varies from people to person to person. You know, we all have a different idea what good color is. However, luminosity, the lightness or darkness, is much less subjective, and I like to say that luminosity trumps color in importance. Okay, so let me show you what I mean here. Here's a picture, and this is a very information-rich image, and we can identify a lot of different details, the number of people, where they're located in the scene, what they're doing, mm-hmm. As well as the other items of interest in the scene. It's all very readily available in this image. But if I drain out all of the lights and darks, and I give you just the color information. So all this is, although it may look like some areas are darker or lighter, that's just a, you know, depending on what your monitor is calibrated to, this is just color with all one level of brightness. And it's really kind of hard to tell what's going on here. Unless you've seen the previous image, you don't really know what this is. So I would submit that we don't really have a photograph here. But if I take the color information away and I leave just the lights and darks, well, it's kind of obvious what this is. You can see all the information that you need to see to know what's going on in this image, and we have no difficulty identifying most of the details in the image.
Okay,
so now when we add the color back, it's an additional level of information to be sure, but you know, whether the color is more saturated or less saturated, or cooler, or warmer, it doesn't have as much impact on the overall image as the range of lights and dark values. Okay, so I always tell people, keep this in mind next time someone tries to sell you on the use of super wide gamut color spaces like Pro Photo RGB. Mm-hmm. It's really much more critical to nail those lights and darks. And this is kind of where the zone system comes in. So what we're looking at here is the, you know, kind of the essential principles for photographic images. And the first thing is capturing images is really recording light. And what that means is that the most important thing is getting exposure right. That's the first step. Next, we want to have to render the exposure in a way that conveys our intention for the image. And this is a creative interpretive process, and it's like in the post-processing end of things. It involves an interplay between tone or value and color. Okay, so color gamut is not the most critical component of the photographic image. The viewer will respond more strongly to lights and darks in the image over color. Everybody's going to have a different idea of whether the color is good or bad, or, you know, whether it's pleasing. But if it lacks contrast, that's readily apparent. And that's one reason that black and white images can be so successful. So it's really essential to control the exposure and the post-processing to creatively interpret the photographic image. So that now brings us to the zone system. I'm going to give you a whole conceptual foundation for the zone system. I call it the 5-minute zone system. Just to make it easier, we're going to do it in 10 minutes.
I'll set my watch.
Right. We'll probably do it in under 10 minutes. But anyway, just so that you can have an understanding of the zone system, I'm going to step through this in the presentation, and if everybody wants to, we'll dive into Photoshop, and I'll recreate this. But first thing we want to do is we're going to build a zone scale, and we start with a new document. I'm just going to create a new document here, and we make it in LAB. So I'm making a strip. This is sort of a classic zone scale. They make a narrow strip, and we set the mode to LAB. Okay, so in the channels panel, and here's our document, right? So in the channels panel, we're going to select the lightness channel, okay? And now we select the gradient tool and choose white to black gradient from the tool option bar. And very important to make sure that the steps that we generate are clean, you want to uncheck the dither checkbox. Okay, then we drag out a black to white gradient. You know, you can hold down the shift key to constrain it to perfect horizontal. Mm-hmm. And the next step is we're going to select posterize from the image menu. And we set the levels in the posterized dialog to 11. Okay, then you'll end up with discrete levels that increment in 10% steps. Okay.
It's the RetouchPRO logo.
It's the RetouchPRO logo. And these correspond roughly to the 10 steps in the zone system. And actually what we have are 11 steps, which includes 0 for absolute black. And this is necessary so that we can place that 50% step right in the middle, and that's our zone 5. So these steps are in even percentages, and they're mostly equivalent, like I said, to the zone system. So 10% is a zone 1, 20% is zone 2, 30% zone 3, and so on. Okay. Now, what we're going to do is show you the RGB values, and I'm just using Adobe RGB, sRGB would be pretty much the same. The reason I'm showing this to you is that you'll notice that 50% is not 128.
Okay, that's interesting.
So the reason this is it's like this is that we work in gamma encoded workspaces. So sRGB and Adobe RGB are so most popular of the kind of editing spaces, and they're gamma encoded so that there's a curve, and it gives us it changes the steps right? So we have a little more on the upper half of the range here than we do on the lower half. And this is kind of, actually, it's a legacy inherited from the power curve of a cathode ray tube, okay, which also in turn mimics the human visual response. So we, you just have to know that 50% is never equal to a value of 128 in any RGB workspace. Okay. So now what I do, what the practical use for this, is to determine how values will print. So what I've got here, I've got three step wedges. There's 21 steps, which are like 5% increments on the top. Then there's 41 steps, and at the very bottom, you can kind of see there's 61 steps, right? So those are like 1.5 increments approximately. Now, you would take this and convert it into RGB, because we remember we're doing this in LAB so that we have a completely linear range, right? Your values in all LAB are totally linear. When it converts to RGB, it's not linear, right? 50% doesn't fall right in the middle. It falls at 118, right?
I'm sorry that you lost me there, because you just said in the previous step that it was not linear, and now you're saying that's...
Well, here in LAB, it's linear, right? Because in LAB, these are measured in percentages. There's our 10 zones, there's our percentages, and these are actual percentage values in LAB.
Okay, so here, 50% is 128.
Right, because LAB is a linear color space. It's not like there's no curve applied to it. There's no gamma curve. It's strictly linear from 0
okay.
to 100. Okay, but when we convert this into RGB, we get these RGB values, and
okay.
You can see they don't progress linearly.
Okay.
They're, these other values. Okay, so what I do here is I generate this image in LAB and then convert it into RGB so I can send it to a printer. So when we print it, then the idea here is to look at where you start to lose separation between the values. So this is especially helpful in visualizing how shadow values get compressed in a print. You usually what happens is you can't find separation below a value of about 15 in RGB. Everything below 15 generally prints the same shade of black. Sometimes on some like glossy papers, you might get it down to about a level of 10. Mm-hmm. So that would be a black level of 10, 10, 10, right?
Right.
What people often do is they set their black point to zero, either intentionally or inadvertently. And so you're losing potential information or detail in the image between 0 and 15. That's 15 levels of which could be textural information that you're just not going to get. And you're not going to get a black that's any blacker, right? You're just going to get a black that's plugged up.
So you're suggesting we would set the 0 point to 10, 10, 10?
If you're intending to print this, yes, I would do, if you're in the business of making prints, then you should be doing these tests yourself with your paper and your printer. It doesn't even matter what color management you use. Very often, the profile does not give you any extra levels, although there's an attempt, using black point compensation, there's an attempt to make zero hit the darkest printable value, but it never works out. I've never seen that work. So it's useful to actually know your numeric limits, right? So we're looking for, if I want to have any sense of detail, I don't want to have a black point that's lower than 15.
And again, you're talking about on the print. You're not talking about on the screen.
Yeah, the screen, it doesn't matter. Your screen is backlit.
Yes.
You're going to see, I can see on this screen now a value, separation way, way down there.
Yeah, yeah.
Very often you don't see that on the print. Almost never are you going to see that kind of detail in the black.
Now, at this point, are you concerned about, you're just concerned about separation? You're not necessarily concerned about delineation?
Well, delineation of the tones, if 15, 15, 15 produces black, and I want the next lightest value to be reproducible, I have to make sure that I don't set my black point, or the darkest point in the image, lower than 15.
Okay. Okay.
Does that make sense?
It does make sense, yes.
Okay. So, and you know, you'll see how we end up using this. So the whole point of the zone system is kind of to develop a way of pre-visualizing how the image will look when it prints. And it's very useful to have this zone scale printed and be able to look at it. And then when you have that visual reference, you can kind of see how a general tone, how light or dark it is on the paper. And it really helps you when you're preparing your image. So if you set up your, here I'm looking at the info panel options, right? So if we set up the second color readout to LAB, we can read LAB values for any area in the image. The other way to do this, of course, is to click on the little eyedropper and select the LAB there. Okay, so while we've got the LAB numbers up, the L value is basically going to give you your zone. So in this case, 87 is really close to 90, which would be a zone 9. It's almost white. It's the first step before paper white.
So you round up, or it's just whatever it's closest to either?
Whatever's closest. In this case, 87 is closer to 90 than it is to 80.
So if it was 83, you would go down to 80.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
Okay, so now you have a way of actually reading a tone in the image, right? But it's still useful to have this printed value so you know when you're reading the image where how dark is this thing going to really print. So on screen, when we put the zone scale on screen, those darker gray patches don't look that dark. But trust me, in a print, they will be much darker, right? So we're looking at this image, and it seems very kind of flat and open, and it's not very dark. But we have this, the zone one is pretty much matching this tone in the mountain, and zone one will look pretty darn black in the print.
Okay.
It won't be absolutely black. Absolute black will be a bit darker than this, but basically what I'm looking for is I want to find the, read values in the image that correspond to zone 1 and zone 9. If I can get the whole image to fall within those two ranges, I can do anything I want with the image.
Now, when you're talking about this, are you there standing there staring at the mountain, or is this presuming you have already captured it?
There's in two ways. Okay, so if I identify something in this image that's a zone 5 and I'm exposing for that, in this case probably the clouds in the upper half of the image would average out to about a zone 5 as far as the meter of the camera is concerned. So I'd expose for that. And if I had a spot meter, if you're a landscape photographer, it's a really good idea to get a technical and get a spot meter so you can actually read the values and make sure if I want to have texture in that mountain peak, is it measuring for a zone 9, which is like higher than zone 5, right? And we want to identify where these points are with our camera. Where do I hit zone 9? Where do I hit zone 1 in my exposure for the camera? So I have to know how many stops overexposed can I be and have that value be at zone 9.
Do you trust the spot meters that are built into cameras nowadays?
Mostly they're not that accurate.
Okay.
You can test. It just sort of depends. Really, these days, we have so much, flexibility and range in the digital file. We can kind of push things around. But for the best absolute best quality. Really, we don't want to overexpose and we don't want to underexpose. And sometimes when we're dealing with a very dark scene, we want to make sure that nothing is falling down below that zone one value. So we may want to intentionally overexpose the scene a little bit. But there's no point in exposing it so that it looks like a snow scene if you're recording dark rock.
Do you have a direction or the other that you would you choose to err to if that's all you've got?
Generally, I'm going to err on the side of overexposing.
Okay.
But the problem with digital capture is that the values kind of fall off the cliff on the high side. If you overexpose and you have highlight values, if you overexpose them, they just clip and you cannot bring them back. Right?
Okay.
So part of the testing procedure is really trying to decide where is it going to fall off the cliff? So I know that I don't push it too far.
So like
the other thing is,
so like I mean, Ansel Adams' famous advice is what expose for the shadows, print for the highlights.
And process, yeah.
Print so that for would the be highlights. That would be flipped for the digital zone system.
Pretty much, you would expose for the highlights and you know, sort of process for the shadows.
Okay.
So it's, you know, it's sort of like instead of shooting transparency film, you're shooting negative film.
Okay, for anybody in our audience that has actually ever shot film.
Right. All three of you out there. now, this is just sort of like the general foundation. I can go into Photoshop and rebuild that step wedge if everybody's interested in that. But, that's really just sort of conceptual. The practical stuff happens when we actually start shooting tests for the camera. So I'm happy to do whatever at this point. I can jump into Photoshop and build that step wedge and talk a little more about that kind of thing.
Well, I do have a couple of questions about that. By the way, is there any way could you move your mic like down a little, down around your chin a little bit? We're getting some of the audiences are complaining about the S's.
Okay, how's that?
I'm
actually moving it away from. I can't really move it down further than I can move it up. I'm moving away from my mouth. It's now up around my eye.
Wow, it's different. We'll live with it a little while and see. So I had a question. Russell wanted to know, why did you use lab when setting up your zone scale? I suspect Russell has read your book because some of the questions are straight out of your PowerPoint presentation. But you said the lab was because it's linear.
Well, It's a linear. If I want steps that posterize, when I do the posterize command, I want the steps to be evenly spaced.
Mm-hmm.
Just to visualize conceptually what that, you know, range of tones is. So in order to have them evenly spaced, I have to be in a linear color space so that they space out evenly. If you're in RGB when you do that, when you posterize it, you'll get something where the dark steps are much closer together and, you know, the light steps are a little further apart, you know, until you get to the top where the last two steps get much closer together. So it doesn't have a linear appearance, and it just makes it, you know, it's just a conceptual thing. If you want your steps to be linear, then you have to have a linear color space.
Okay, I'll just let everybody know that I've got a step wedge tutorial over at RetouchPRO.com in the tutorial section. There is a step you can add if you really want to stick in RGB that will counteract basically the exact same thing that Lee's talking about. But just doing it in lab is a really, really easy way of doing it. And then you would convert it to RGB before you actually, you know, use it in your imaging.
Well, remember, we're just going to print this.
Yes.
So I convert it to RGB so that I can get values, RGB values. I can write those values down and know, oh, when I hit 33, I'm at a zone 1.
So you don't actually recommend layering a step wedge with your image, at least not even for diagnostic purposes.
No, not really. I mean, I just put this up here as a visual reference so people can look
at it.
Okay. What I recommend, though, is printing the step wedge.
Okay.
Printing the step wedge will tell you an awful lot about you know, how light or dark a value in your image will print. Because very often I find that when people are preparing their images and then they intend to print them, they're always making them too dark. They're making it too dark because the monitor is backlit. It has nothing to do with your monitor calibration.
Okay.
It can be perfectly calibrated, but we're just not, you know, we're very used to looking at things backlit. When you put it on a piece of paper, it's not backlit. So everything starts looking much darker. And the only way to really begin to visualize that is to print out the step wedge. So if I go along the step wedge and say I find a zone 6, right, sort of a, it's just a bit lighter than 50% gray, well, that actually looks pretty dark in the print. So if I'm making my person's skin at zone 6, it's like that's maybe too dark for, you know, a Caucasian skin.
Mm-hmm.
And it looks fine on the screen.
So you would print this step wedge out using the same profiles and inks and everything,
yeah,
that you want to for your
right,
working image. And I'm guessing that if you use a different printer, or if you change inks, or if you change profile or whatever, you're going to want to print it again to accustom your eyes and basically so you can translate the image to your printer.
Yeah, it helps you develop your sense, your visual reference.
So we're not recalibrating the printer, we're recalibrating the editor, you.
Yeah, well, in a way, yes.
Okay, that makes sense.
The printer doesn't really care. It's only taking the numbers that you throw at it.
Excellent.
And, you know, there's always been an attempt to try to get the monitor to reflect what the print looks, and you have the soft proofing functionality in Photoshop, and now you even have it in Lightroom. But it only goes so far.
Yeah, it is kind of an exercise in futility if you do not use it day in, day out.
Yeah.
So really, this is...
People don't want to look at their monitor looking shitty.
Yes, yeah.
You know, it drives people crazy. And basically, that's what the soft proofing does. It just makes your monitor look shitty.
Yes, yeah.
And then the print doesn't look as shitty as the monitor does. So, you know, like, it's better to just kind of, I mean, if you get used to looking at the numbers. I mean, I have my info panel open all the time.
Mm-hmm.
It's very quick to run your cursor over the image and just get a real quick hit on, like, how light or dark that really is.
Mm-hmm.
And you have your step wedge in front of you to kind of go, oh, yeah, well, that's pretty dark. Maybe I should lighten that up. Or, you know, conversely, gee, that could be a little bit darker here, you know.
So it's kind of like a reality check to keep you grounded to your printer's reality.
Right.
Excellent.
And then, you know, see what I show here, basically, you got, you know, here's the flat scene, but as long as my range in the captured image, and this is like a flat raw file, right, no enhancements done, but as long as I have that range, it's really easy to put more detail in the shadows and in the highlights and, you know, craft the image any way I want, right?
Now, is there a Lightroom equivalent to this?
Well, you know, Lightroom Info, it is actually a little bit more like LAB.
Okay.
Because it's giving you percentage numbers.
Mm-hmm.
So that I'm going to use that as a way to segue into the calibrating exercise here, right? So we need to calibrate the camera so we know exactly how to expose your camera.
Excellent.
Everything's that. You know, the cameras roll off the assembly line. They're all pretty close, but there's subtle differences from one camera to the next. There's subtle differences in how the camera meter is calibrated. And you have to kind of test also with the lenses that you're going to be using and your lighting, right? So it's, you know, test the camera, lens, and lighting. It's one complete system. Okay. So we're going to shoot an exposure range. And then adjust the color for the color temperature of the light that we shoot in.
Mm-hmm.
And then in Lightroom or Camera Raw, you can save settings and create like a camera default.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So each time you import things from this raw, from this particular camera, your settings will be set up so that you don't have to do this every time, right? You're only going to test once.
I think I'm with you on every step except the lighting. Are you going to have a – yeah, okay, great, excellent.
Okay, so you know, this is what I consider like an ideal test target. The only thing you absolutely need, you need to have this color reference target. You know, I'm using the X-Rite color checker here, which used to be known as the Macbeth color checker, and it originally was the Munsell chart. Okay, and that was after the scientists that developed it. And this has been around for over 50 years. Uh-huh. They used it in the early days of television, and, you know. And supposedly these patches represent real-world color values, like the two the upper left corner, the brown and sort of the tan. That's supposed to represent skin tone. But of course, I've never seen a person that had skin that color.
Because they may be 50 years ago, but...
yeah. So, you know, since, you know, color is such a problematic, you know, skin tone is such a problematic color, it's usually a good idea to have a, you know, human subject. In this case, I'm jumping in the shot myself, with a self-timer. I also like to have a light trap. So this is like a box with a hole cut in it, and the inside of the box is lined with velvet. So it's a deep shadow. You can't always guarantee that you're going to have a deep shadow somewhere else, but that will definitely give you the deepest shadow reference. And that's
kind of
again,
cool.
It's sort of not critical to have this, but I like to see it so I can get a quick reference for how dark the darkest thing in the capture is. And the same thing with the white. I have a styrofoam lens packing material here that's it's sort of diffused, reflective, and it always clips to white. You know, it's a nice thing to refer to. Not critical. Again, as I said, the only thing you really need is this color chart. I have this, see this 100 written there? That's a reference that I use. I'll write that down if that's the expected exposure index for this particular exposure. And it's just another quick way. These, again, now are not really that critical because you can always look at the metadata of the file to find out how you expose something.
And you just do this on a sunny day at noon or something like that?
Well, yeah, you kind of, I shoot in the sun, open shade, and in tungsten light.
Ah, okay, okay.
What for the color target, you know, there's a different software packages available. X-Rite has the, you know, color passport This you know, data color has the spider, you know, I think it's called the spider checker, and they have different ways of you know, you take a picture of this target and then you calibrate it, builds inside of a sort of a custom profile that works inside of Camera Raw or Lightroom, and it's like you can buy the software, it will run like a plug-in, so you take this picture, you bring it into Lightroom, and you export it through this plug-in, and it will generate the profile that calibrates your capture to the known values of the color check. Because there are published LAB values for these targets. Okay, so, and this is where I recommend using a handheld light meter, because the light meter, and especially if you use, what I like to use is the spot meter function in these multimeters. You know, I like the Siconic meter, but any handheld light meter will work. Because I can actually put a little spot and read the middle gray patch, and it makes it easy to calibrate to know that I'm getting an absolutely accurate exposure of, or at least a starting exposure of this target. Okay, so the incident meter is always going to give you a zone 5 value. You know, an exposure that's intended to give you an accurate exposure of that zone 5 patch. Okay, so the idea is we take this, we do this capture, and we bracket the exposures, bring it into Lightroom, and start measuring. Okay.
So, well, now one second. I get the incident part, and I get the spot meter part, but if we don't have a spot meter, if we just have a reflective meter. Will that work?
If you're using an average meter,
yeah.
it's not ideal, but
It's better than nothing, basically.
It's better than nothing. So if you're, like, for instance, if you have to use your camera built-in meter, your camera built-in meter has some sort of averaging function. Even the spot meter is not, it doesn't give you a really accurate spot, even though they probably could. We're dealing with sort of legacy issues coming from film cameras.
And yeah.
They develop these metering systems that average all the brightness values in the scene and then compare them to, you know, thousands of other shots to try and guess at the correct exposure for the average brightness values, right? Sort of like exposure through statistics, right? And that's great for, like, you know, it's sort of down and dirty way of getting close enough. Mm-hmm. And I figure, hey, you know, close enough, you can adjust it in Photoshop, right? Or iPhoto, for that matter. to be absolutely accurate, you know, the handheld meter allows you, especially this, you know, the incident meter will always, if you point it at the light source, it's going to give you a zone 5 reading for that level of light falling on the subject.
Now, we are assuming here that the user knows how to use their white meter, or knows how to use their light meter. That goes beyond the scope of this.
Yeah. Yeah.
Robert wants to know if you have an opinion about the Expo disc.
Well, the Expo disc works pretty much like an incident light meter. You put it on the lens, you point the camera at the light source, so you generally have to walk over to your subject and point around. It's exactly like using an incident light meter.
But if you're walking over to your subject, that kind of defeats the purpose of the Expo disc other than saving the cost of the incident meter.
Well, yeah, it saves you the cost of the incident. I generally don't like, incident meters are really valuable if you are controlling the light, if you in fact have lights that you're turning in, controlling the intensity of,
yeah.
And you need to measure ratios, right? So you've got a fill light that you want to be at a certain ratio. An incident meter is great for that. But if you're taking a picture of a subject, and you're not taking a picture of a gray card, but you're taking a picture of a person, you decide, well, you know, I want this skin to be like a zone 8 value. I want to be really pale.
Mm-hmm.
It's a blonde girl. I want to be really pale. I could walk out there with a gray card and measure the light coming off the gray card, and that would be pretty much like walking into the set and, you know, using an incident meter.
Right.
But now I'm making a choice. I want to measure the actual value coming off the skin. I don't care about the intensity of the light. I care about the light value that I'm recording with the camera. So I want to record the light reflecting off the skin. In that case, having a reflected meter is really valuable because I can put the little, you know, spot.
A reflected spot meter, we must specify.
Right. Yeah, well, nowadays any meter you buy that's a reflected meter is basically going to be a spot meter.
Oh, okay. It's been a while since I've been shopping.
Handheld meter, it's going to be a spot meter.
Ah,
good. You see a little circle, and you can place that right on the skin and go, okay, I know I should open up, you know, a stop and a half here.
Or in a pinch, we can use the little 1% circle in our camera. As long as we've tested it, like you said.
You know, if you can zoom in a little bit so you fill the frame pretty much with the skin, you can use it that way as well.
Okay.
Okay, so, again, this is just like if you really wanted to be anal.
Who doesn't?
You know? and there are drugs for that condition, too. I think the most important thing takeaway here is that don't rely on the LCD on the back of the camera. Okay.
Ah, okay.
You need to have people tape it up.
Ah.
Don't look at that thing because your judgment of the LCD, it depends on the ambient light.
So you're not a fan of chimping, then, as they call it.
Chimping is great if you want to check to see if somebody blinked or not.
but not for exposure.
Yeah, very often it can be a misleading. And, you know, like if you're in a really bright ambient light condition, you're out at the beach, and you're trying to look at the, you know, the LCD and decide, is this bright enough? You know, it's like, it'll look dark because you're, everything's so bright around it.
Okay. So don't use it for self-proving, in other words.
Right. You're in a really dark room, and you're looking at the image, and it's like, you know, you're at a concert. You're trying to decide, is this bright enough?
Mm-hmm.
It's going to look brighter because you're in a dark room. Right. Right.
What about the histogram?
Yeah, if you're looking at the histogram typically is a composite. It's an average of red, green, and blue. And if you're taking pictures of red roses, the composite histogram is not really going to be accurate for what is basically red. And even if you can display the separate RGB histograms, because some cameras allow you to do that, it's still not that accurate, except as a rough approximation of the camera JPEG.
As I understand it, it's basically the histogram of the JPEG. Is that
exactly
okay?
It's a histogram of the JPEG, so you can't really see what's in the raw file by looking at the histogram.
Okay.
And very often there's more information in the raw file than you could show on the histogram.
This has nothing to do with anything. It crossed my mind just now. Are you a fan of tethering?
In certain situations, it's really ideal. I
okay.
mean, if you're shooting in the studio and you want to see the results on a big screen right away,
maybe there's another show there. It's just
tethering is the way to go.
Okay.
But, you know, obviously if you're hanging off the side of a mountain with a rope and you're trying to get a picture, you're not going to be tethering.
Oh, I don't know. They've got Wi-Fi and everything now.
anyway, so our goal here is to determine the actual exposure index, you know, for the camera.
Mm-hmm.
And that requires is shooting the series of exposures. And we're going to bracket exposures around what the expected default should be.
How wide of a bracket do you think is usable?
Well, I used to say 3 stops on the highlight side and 4 stops on the shadow side.
Wow.
Nowadays, I say 4 and 4 at least.
Wow.
Just to make sure that you cover it.
And in what increments?
The smallest increments that your camera supports. So I go on 3rd stops.
Seriously? Wow. So you're basically talking about a day's work here calibrating.
Oh, it doesn't take that long to shoot this stuff, really. You know, it's not going to take you a day to shoot this. Maybe it'll take you an hour or 2 hours, maybe. It's not that bad. But when I say here change the exposure index reference on the target, that's that 180, you know, if this exposure should be ideal for an ISO 100, then I write 100 down there. Now, if I open up a 1/3 of a stop and that gives me my correct value, then my actual ISO would be 80.
Okay, so you're not constantly rewriting new notes all the time. That you're just writing the first one so you know what your baseline is, and then later on you're interpolating based on your measurements.
Yeah. Yeah, so these are, you know, the 100, 80, 64, 50, these are the ISO numbers, right? So starting with very low, you know, most cameras, the lowest they'll go is ISO 100. If yours only goes to 200, then that's where you're going to start, right? You're going to set your ISO in your camera for 200 and then make a range of exposures and find out what is the real ISO of my camera.
Mm-hmm.
The only way to find out is to look at the test exposures. So here I say just shoot 3 stops on either side of normal, and now I'm saying with the newer cameras, I think it's useful to go 4 stops.
So basically at a 1/3 of a stop, you're talking about 12 exposures either direction.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, and then when you bring it into Bridge or Lightroom, I'm going to use Lightroom here, just make sure you've got 0 slider, nothing, you know, your default is not applying any adjustment.
Mm-hmm.
And then we're going to look at the exposures and try to find the one that has the closest rendering of middle gray, and then that would be the ideal exposure. And you'd be surprised. Sometimes it doesn't always turn out to be exactly what the manufacturer tells you it's going to be. So, Canon camera may say, okay, here are your ideal ISO. We can set the ISO to 100, so we'd expect a certain exposure here. And you have to open up 1/3 of a stop to get that rendering. You know that, you know, the actual ISO is a little off. And it's also interesting under different colored light. So typically under tungsten light, the ISO rating is sort of optimistic.
Okay. So basically you're going to measure that middle gray square and it needs to be 128. The one that reads 128, that's your ISO right there?
Well, remember in RGB it would have to read 118. But if we're using Lightroom, we're actually going to see the sort of Lightroom percentage numbers, which are actually closer to LAB. So you look for percentages. You look for 50%. I'll show you what I mean in a minute. But let's just step through this.
Okay.
So, you want to make sure that you're not applying any, you know, developed settings. It's just zeroed, right?
Mm-hmm.
If you don't have a custom camera calibration to start with, then I would use, the camera neutral. Sometimes they say camera flat. Or something like that. Don't use the Adobe standard. That always gives it a little extra contrast.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And then we look at the chart or the sequence of exposures, and we're going to go and actually zoom in and click on the gray patch, the lightest gray patch to get a color balance. So we adjust for the color balance of whatever the color temperature light is. I can go into Lightroom. Why don't I do that? Let's see. I forgot to open up my zone test target here. All right. So here's my. You know, these are just the way they came in off the camera. And I just, you know, because I'm lazy, I didn't want to jump back and forth.
Mm-hmm.
I just shot the target. Okay, so this is perfectly valid. You can do this. Right, so I start with what I assume is the normal exposure. Right. So I'm going to actually neutralize the color temperature. So I'll go into the develop module and get my light balance tool. And Thomas Knoll says, click on this patch. It's the ideal one to set the color temperature so you nicely, it cools it off, it's neutralized. You see the RGB numbers under the histogram here. It's all pretty close to, you know, within one percentage or two percentage points.
Mm-hmm.
Two-tenths of a percentage points or so of neutral, right? They all should be relatively neutral, right, across here. So I select. These are all done under tungsten light. You can see they're kind of warm. There's my exposure range for tungsten light. I select all of that and click on sync. I haven't made any adjustments. I'm really only concerned about syncing the white balance, but I could go ahead and synchronize everything. Everything's just zero. Right? So I'm making no adjustments. I'm just neutralizing the color for the white point.
Okay.
Now, here's my middle gray patch, okay? So in Lightroom, because Lightroom, if you see the RGB numbers that show up under the histogram there, in this case it says red 38.1, green 37.9, blue 38.9.
Uh-huh.
Okay, so it's a little on the cool side, but it's within one percentage of being absolutely neutral, right?
Except it's supposed to be 50%, though, isn't it?
We'd like that to be 50%. Now, this is the exposure that my ISO 100 told me should be correct.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not. It's a little underexposed. So I want to go to the next one is a little bit brighter, and let's read that. So this is 44.5,
45.9,
45.2. Closer, mm-hmm. Right? One more third of the stop. Okay, 50.4, 50, 50.4, and 51.3. So it seems like it's a little on the cool side. I might, click on it just to get it a little closer. But still, clearly we are much closer to 50% here. And this is two-thirds of a stop up. So my ISO 100, this is, the camera says, this is ISO 100, this is your correct exposure. The actual measuring for ideal patch, this is the correct exposure. So I'm more like ISO 64 here.
Okay.
Now, and this is for tungsten light with my, in this case, I think this is a, this is a, this is the Canon, it's the 5D Mark III.
Okay. Now, is your lens going to play much into this?
If you're shooting with Canon and you use all Canon glass, you could just pick whatever lens you use most of the time.
Okay.
And the Canon glass will be very consistent.
It's really more about the sensor, which isn't going to change.
Right. But if you say you use all Canon glass, but there's this one Tokina lens that you like, mm-hmm. the color bias of the lens will factor into it. Again, depending on how obsessive compulsive you want to be. You know, if you really want to be critical, if you're doing scientific work, mm-hmm. you know, maybe you'd want to calibrate, you know, for the, you know, each different
okay.
manufacturer lens.
You if nothing else, it'd be good to try so you can see if it's, you know, like
yeah,
you said, it's
I mean, all. Right. And you know, most people, if they have Canon, they're using Canon glass. If they have Nikon, they're using Nikon glass. You could be happy. You don't have to worry about it. Right. But if you're mixing and matching manufacturers' lenses, then maybe that's something.
So whenever you say 65, that's because 50 would be a full stop more, and you've already calculated this is two-thirds of a stop, and so you're just basically saying, you know, one-third, two-thirds, that's 67. Or 60.
Right.
Okay.
So, yeah, I'm opening up two-thirds of a stop to arrive at the ideal exposure here. Now, this may not be the way I'm always going to process my images. I might, you know, put some contrast in here. In fact, that would be kind of normal to put a little bit of contrast in there, right? But to find that value, because, you know, you change the contrast around, it's supposed to move it around this center point, right? So, but all of those, anything you do with the sliders here will skew how this thing is captured, but to have the maximum flexibility in how you're going to interpret this file, you want to expose accurately for that middle patch.
So now that we have that 65 number, what do we do with it?
Well, now we know that whenever we are using the camera, let's just assume that you use the camera meter to determine. Mm-hmm. The camera meter said, this is the exposure, right? Mm-hmm. And you see, well, actually, it's two-thirds of a stop up.
Okay.
You can use your exposure compensation in your camera to open up two-thirds. And
okay.
That would be your baseline for your you know readings under tungsten light. Make sense?
Yeah, it does. Because, well, see, my question was because if you just tell your camera that this is ISO 65, it's going to come back with exactly the same exposure that you got
yeah,
the first time.
Yeah, you have to use exposure compensation. You have
okay.
to figure out what your exposure compensation is. Because the camera, I mean, you can only set, it's not, you can't change the ISO manually.
Yeah, okay.
You set the ISO, and then the camera does everything else automatically.
Exactly, put you right back
so
to where you were.
It's going to compensate no matter what. So you have to dial in the exposure compensation. In this case, it's two-thirds.
So the two-thirds is more important than the 65 ISO. That was more of a translation.
Yeah, it's just that's just a conceptual thing. It's
okay.
Like the real ISO of this camera is not 100 under tungsten light.
Okay.
And so on the flip side of things, let's go now to the shadow side. And, actually, we can find out where zone one is for this patch, right? So we know we're starting here. We're opening up two-thirds just to arrive at zone five. We set our plus two-thirds exposure. And now I want to know how far can I overexpose before I really lose information in that.
Okay, let me pause you here for 1 second. We've already established that that's a zone five.
Yeah.
So what you're wanting to know is how much you can overexpose so that, but that will still print because it will not be below zone one, which we determined back
well,
in our.
In this case, if I'm overexposed, I'm looking for this to be at zone nine.
Okay.
Right? So if I, you know, I have a brighter exposure here, this patch gets brighter. Right now it's at 75, roughly. We'll go one more. You know, now we're in the 80, so that would be like a zone eight.
Mm-hmm.
Let's go one more. You know, now it says 86.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see, can I go one more? 90.
Yeah.
Right, bingo. That's our, you know, and so I'm like marking this with a red out. You can see the red outlines.
Mm-hmm.
So that's my zone 5. This is my zone 9. Now let's count up from here. How many stops overexposed can I go before I turn a normal exposure overexposed past zone 9?
Mm-hmm.
So one-third, two-thirds, one stop. One-third, two-thirds, two stops. So 2 1/3 stops gets me to zone 9.
Okay.
Okay. So if I'm looking at a scene that, you know, is a snow scene and there's a white bunny rabbit on it, and I kind of know, you know, this whole thing should average in to be really pale, should be a zone 9.
Mm-hmm.
This is a safe exposure. I can go 2 1/3 stops over what my meter is saying and still be safe because I'm well within range. And, you know, we can darken this down if I need to. I can, you know, put clarity on it, put some contrast in it. I can bring the highlights. I can do all kinds of things because I have plenty of range. Okay. So now I do the same thing on the shadow side. I go and I'm looking now for where is this patch going to be a zone 1, which would be 10%. So here I'm at 9, 9, so that's pretty close. Let's see, maybe I should go a little lighter. There's 11.7, and this one was 9.2, so it's kind of in between these two.
Okay.
I'd probably say just go with this one. This is still pretty safe. We can underexpose again. Now we have to. This is now 2/3 to arrive at this one. This was the normal one. So I have to underexpose 2/3 to arrive at this one. One stop. 1/3, 2/3. Two stops, 1/3, 2/3, 2/3. So yeah. 2 2/3, right? I'm at my zone 1, which is 10%. So at 9%, I'm pretty close to 10% here. Okay, does this make sense?
Yeah.
And that's it for the test. That's what you do. So now I know what my limits are, my actual, you know, these are practical limits. I used to say, you know, let's find out where this really clips. And what's interesting is that past this zone 9 on the shadow side, you have to go pretty far before you really get any tonal merger between, you know, this patch and black.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if we zoom in here, you know, you have to go way, way down here. And that's just the nature of the digital capture. It seems to be there's a long sort of toe where you still have shadow detail way, way dark. On the highlight side, however, it falls off the clip rather rapidly. But between the zone 1, which would be this one, the zone 1 here, and the zone 9, there's a pretty good range of information. You can kind of push it anywhere you want.
Now, one thing and pardon me if this is a tangent, but you went to, what was it, 2 1/3 down, 2 2/3 up, which is essentially 5 stops.
Yes.
But aren't there more 5 stops between 1 and 9?
Not as far as the camera's concerned.
Okay, so in theory, yes, but in actual printing, no.
These are somewhat arbitrary because we're just arbitrarily dividing the range up into equal steps.
And that's really why we're doing this, is to try to internalize the response of the camera.
Right. Now, in the good old days of film, you do these tests and shoot exhaustive tests, and you'd print them out, and you were more concerned about what would happen with one stop of change in exposure. We don't really care, because I can make this value, I can push this around anywhere I want.
Okay.
I can make it darker, you know, just using exposures slider. I can make it lighter. I can, you know, I can, it's not, film, you had much less flexibility. But I want to know where that's going to be in a useful range for me. And I want to know where, you know, if I go too much further, then it becomes harder to separate
okay.
tonal values. Right. So, and that's basically it. That's the zone test.
Mm-hmm.
And we do this for the two, for tungsten and for, here's just open shade. So this is a bluer color temperature. And for instance, let's just very quickly measure for middle gray. See, this one's already, this one's much more accurate. We're at 50 or 51 here.
Which actually makes sense. That's why.
So cool, the meter responds differently to cool colored temperature yeah. than warm colored temperature. So with tungsten, I have to open up two-thirds. So that's already given me a lot of information for this camera. When I'm shooting under tungsten light, I have to put a two-thirds plus two-thirds compensation when I know I'm shooting under tungsten light. And under daylight, especially in the open shade, I just leave it alone. I don't put an exposure compensation.
Okay.
So I'm kind of running out of time here in my, because I've got an appointment to get to.
Okay.
I'm sorry about that.
No. Have we covered most of what you were planning on talking about?
Yeah, pretty much. I can finish up in my my keynote here. Let's see. Just very briefly, you know, I say the lens here. This is a lens baby, which is a goofy butt lens. It has
yeah.
a weird color and everything. But, you know, if I'm interested in, you know, being critical with this lens, then I would shoot a test with the lens baby to calibrate for, you know, for this particular lens and how it affects things.
Mm-hmm.
Now, just I'm going to briefly mention, you know, the white balance at the shoot, because it's always a good idea to shoot a color reference so that when you get bring it into Lightroom later on, you can calibrate your color. Now, I show this. These are still around in camera stores. Do not let somebody at the camera store sell you this.
Yeah, these expire, don't they?
Yeah, well, these, by now, they're definitely expired. But these were really intended for doing custom color management, you know, custom profiles, ICC-type profiles.
Uh-huh.
And we sort of got over that when we started working with RAW capture, because with a RAW file, you can process it into any color space you want.
Yeah.
You don't really need to go through this color management thing. But I've seen people come back to me at workshops with these color checkers, and it's like, this is just a headache. It's a recipe for disaster. For your gray references, you really only need something that's, you know, simple gray reference. This is one that's available. It has, you know, white, gray, and black, but they're all spectrally neutral. This is one that I like. It's the Robin Myers gray card. It's actually a piece of plastic, so it's pretty indestructible. This is another one, The Last Delight. This is kind of a pop-up, so it's white on
the Yeah, I was going to ask you, what about some of the multi-purpose ones? Like the inside of an umbrella or whatever. The ones that are designed for such a purpose.
Right. I mean, you could use this as a reflector, as the other side is white, you know, and it is neutral. It's certainly neutral enough to use it, and it's a nice big size, so I kind of like this. But there's a number available, and so you want to make sure you shoot this reference for neutral color, if at all possible,
mm-hmm.
you know, because that's going to give you a leg up in your post-processing.
At least once on the day you're shooting, so you get in the same light you're shooting.
Right. Now, here I say, you know, do white balance in camera if you're going to hand off the processing to a third party. So if you're handing your RAW files to a color lab, then, you know, doing the white balance in camera may give you a better result.
I think on RetouchPRO.com, I think we're pretty safe that's not going to happen.
Yeah, I doubt that anyone's going to do that. And I use a gray card for RAW file processing, and they say to use a white card for in-camera color balancing. It doesn't really matter.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you can also shoot through colored filters to bias the gray balance. So you know, that's something to experiment with if you want to.
Sounds rather old school. Is that something
it
that...
It is kind of old school, but now when we're shooting video, that can be quite handy.
Huh.
Right? Because if you're shooting video, you can't fix it in post, you know, it's much harder anyway. So the thing to remember here is to expose for good data, not necessarily for good look. So if you want it to look dark, don't underexpose it.
You know, okay.
Expose correctly, and then in your post-processing, you can make it look how you want. And this is the, you know, standard rule of thumb. Shoot for the histogram values as far right as possible without clipping highlights. Yes, you know, right? Shoot to the right.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, again, keeping your shadow values away from the left. But if you're tested for your proper exposure index like this, you don't need the histogram. You used your exposure in your meter to figure out where your zones 9 and 1 are and expose appropriately.
And we already covered that your histogram is probably going to be inaccurate in the field anyway.
Yeah, to a certain extent it is, right? So, and this is where, you know, all of your creative stuff is going to happen in the post-processing. Okay. And so this is just, you know, my website is varis.com. I also have a course on courses.varis.com.
Mm-hmm.
Here's that book.
Yes, the book.
Mastering Exposure in the Zone System for Digital Photographers. This outlines the testing procedure. I will say that the screenshots now are a little out of date because,
Yeah, technology marches on, but the concepts are still there.
The concepts and this actual exposing strategy, all of that's the same. My other popular book is Skin, The Complete Guide to Digitally Lighting, Photographing, and Retouching Faces and Bodies. And that's both of these books are still available on Amazon. And I have this course. It's actually not at Udemy anymore. Go to my website. I forgot to change this. It's courses.varis.com.
Okay.
But I have a discount for you guys.
Oh, cool.
If you type in YouTube50 as your coupon code.
Yeah, not at Udemy.
Yeah, the course isn't at Udemy anymore. It's at varis.com, so look up for courses.varis.com. And I have another course on PPSOP for Photoshop Layers. It's called Photoshop Layers Fundamentals, and you can go to ppsop.net or .com and find this course. And I have a DVD available at Photoshop Cafe. And you can like me on Facebook and sign up for my email newsletter, and you'll get like a free PDF of the testing procedure for the zone system. So,
oh, cool!
If you don't want to buy the zone system book, you can get basically the core of the book for free by getting this PDF, and you get that by signing up for my email newsletter.
Excellent.
And that is that.
Do you have time for some questions, or do you have to get out of here?
Well, I can take like 5 minutes. I got to get out of here by 5:30, so I'm,
Let's see here. Mason wants to know if he's adjusting for exposure in manual mode, should he use the f-stop or the shutter speed?
Oh, that's a good question. With digital capture, you're actually the shutter speed is likely to be slightly more accurate in terms of...
Really?
Yeah.
Excellent.
Because it's electronically timed.
Okay.
When shooting film, that was not necessarily true. You know, it was better to have the f-stops.
Uh-huh.
Now we're just really talking about obsessive compulsive.
Okay.
Modern cameras are so good that I think you can pretty much do either one.
Okay, so really, it's all
depending. Depending on what your light levels are, you may have to bracket.
Any old school about, is anything moving? Do you need depth of field? That kind of thing.
Exactly.
Personally, I always use the shutter speed because you can reduce depth of field in Photoshop, but you can't increase depth of field in Photoshop. So
no, right.
let's see here. Mike noticed during your demonstration that you were using DNG. Do you have a particular reason for? Does that have anything to do with what we're talking about, or is that just your own personal preference?
No, DNG is just as kind of Adobe's published raw file format. And they've been promoting it as a way of future-proofing your raw files. I don't really think that argument holds any water, because I suspect that Canon and Nikon will be around longer than Adobe, but, you know, anything could happen, I suppose. I don't think that those, you know, there will always be somebody that supports whatever raw format you shoot in now. Somebody will make some software that supports it. But the reason I use DNG is it's a really good file validator. So when I'm in a hurry and I want to make sure that the, you know, thousands of shots that I just took on, you know, today's photo shoot are good while I'm going through them, I run them through the DNG converter. And if it succeeds, the file is good. If it fails, then it's no good, and I may be using a bum camera card. So
okay.
That's really the whole reason I do that.
Okay. Now, Russell asks a question. I'm not 100% certain what it means, but I'm fascinated to know what the answer is. He says, how do you measure the acceptable luminance variation in an image to determine noise floor?
Well, one of the reasons I picked that zone 1 value is that zone is not going to have any noise in it. You
okay.
are going to have noise in values lower than that. How low it goes depends on your camera.
Okay.
And you can, you know, you can get in there and zoom in and look and see what exposure do you see unacceptable noise for you.
So really, if you stay within the acceptable range that we have tested, you are automatically going to be taking that into consideration, even though you didn't know you were taking it into consideration.
Right. Yeah. If you're not underexposing below that zone 1 value, you're not going to have any significant noise, unless you're at a really high ISO. And usually, you know, with the modern cameras, there's so little noise in these things. People obsess about noise that will never show up in a print.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I would say people worry about noise way more than it actually deserves to be worried about. But, you know.
Okay. Well, actually, that brings up an important point that I think you touched on during your presentation, but you didn't really make explicit. Whenever you do your testing, you had that little card with the 100 on there. You're going to want to do that, what, up to what, some people go up to 1600 or whatever, and you're going to want to do this exact same test?
You know, only if that is something that you do all the time.
Well, yeah, but if you do it, you need to run the test, right?
You know, I don't think it's really that necessary.
Really? Okay, good.
Again, it's all just how obsessive compulsive do you really need to be? And I don't think realistically it's all that critical. Now, if you are, say, always shooting under low light conditions,
mm-hmm.
You may want to test, instead of testing for the you know, the lowest ISO, you may want to test for the highest ISO, because that will affect your dynamic range. So you're going to end up at zone 1 and zone 9 faster with their higher ISOs.
And the question about the noise floor, actually, that's what prompted me to think about that, because if you're shooting at 6400, you're going to have a lot of noise down there.
Well, yeah, you'll find you could be two-thirds of a stop less dynamic range on either side at the highest ISO.
Marvelous.
So you just want, you know, again, if that's something that you do all the time, it may be important for you to test for that.
Okay.
If not, then don't worry about it.
Any final parting thoughts?
Well, I mean, basically, I think even though digital capture gives us so much more information and it's just so easy to adjust things in post, I think for the best possible quality, it's still a good idea to test.
Like, yes, absolutely.
You know, so it just, you know, you can get away with like crazy bad quality and make it look good. But if you start off with really good information, it makes it much, just the quality is much better overall. It makes it easier.
Good data in, good data out.
Exactly. So that's what this is all about.
Marvelous, marvelous. Well, Lise, thank you so much for sharing your time with us here today. We want to make sure that you get out of here on time.
And
I've gotten to the majority of the questions. Let's see. I want to remind everybody that this show will be uploaded to YouTube, so you can review it at your leisure. Again, if you're watching us now on YouTube, if you take a moment to like the video and to subscribe to our channel, I would certainly appreciate it. I want to remind everybody about our rental videos over at retouchpro.com/rentals. So you can see the real-time start-to-finish retouching videos and the various other shows we have over there. And also make sure everyone registers at retouchpro.com so that you can receive notifications of any future shows. Well, all right. Well, I want to thank everyone for showing up today. A special thanks to Lee Varis. And I will see everyone in the forums. Bye-bye, everyone. Bye-bye, Lee.
All right. Bye-bye.